Jerry Clower is Director of Field Services for the Mississippi Chemical Company. He lives in Yazoo City, Mississippi. He's a real nice fella, and I'm glad you came to hear him. Jerry, come visit with us.
First of all, I want you to know that I come from Route 4, Liberty, Mississippi. Now, that's 12 miles west of Macomb, Mississippi, 65 miles due northeast of Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and 116 miles due north of New Orleans, Louisiana. It was there that I first saw the light of day out at Amite County, September the 28th, 1926. I was born there. Now, as I grew up in that community, the only extracurricular activities that we engaged in was to go coon hunting or go to revival meeting if we had a crop laid by. And that's all we did except work. And this particular day that I want to tell you about is one evening when we were going coon hunting. We had a pack of hounds. When we went to mill with our corn to get it ground up, we'd get some ground for dog bread, and we'd get some ground for just regular corn meal for human consumption. This particular day, we wasn't too busy. All we had done is just cut down a few fence rows, shuck and shell some corn and went to mill, drew up some water because that was wash day, helped get the sow back, what rooted out from under the net wire fence, sharpened two sticks of stove wood real sharp and pegged them down over the bottom wire of the fence where the hog couldn't root out no more. And had a rat killing. If I'm lying, I'm dying. We had rat killings in those days. Well, this particular day after we got through the rat killing, I walked out on the front porch and I hollered, and them dogs come out from under the house barking. They knew we was going coon hunting. And I hollered again, and my neighbor way across the sage patch hollered back. And that meant I'll meet you halfway. We met in the middle of that sage patch, and he had his dogs, old Brummy and Queen and Spot, and I had Tory and Little Red and old Trailer. And we went out into the swamps, and we started hunting. Oh, we was having such a fine time. Caught four great big ones. I heard a racket, and it scared me, and I whooped my carbide light, what I had wired to my cap, around there, and I was looking in the vicinity of where I heard the racket coming from. And the beam of light hit a man right in the face, and it like him to have scared me slapped to death because we was hunting on this man's place. I said, "Mr. Barron, is that you?" He said, "Yes, Jerry. What are y'all doing?" "We hunting." "How many have you caught?" "Four great big ones." He said, "Well, boys, glad to see you. Y'all want to spend the rest of the evening hunting with me and John?" Well, I looked, and lo and behold, there was John Eubanks, a man that lived on Mr. Barron's place. John Eubanks was a great American. He was a professional tree climber. He didn't believe, I'm telling you the truth, he didn't believe in shooting no coon out of no tree. It was against his upbringing. He taught us from birth, from the day we were born till the age we could keep listening to him, give everything a sporting chance. Whatever you do, give it a sporting chance. He'd have been a great conservationist today if he'd be here. And John said, "Take a crosscut saw coon hunting with you. When you tree a coon, hold the dogs and cut the tree down. Or either climb the tree and make the coon jump in amongst the dogs. Give him a sporting chance." A lot of times we climb a tree and make a coon jump in amongst 20 dogs. But at least he had the option of whooping all them dogs and walking off if he wanted to. This is strictly left up to the coon. So I said, "Mr. Barron, we'd be glad to go hunting with you." You know, he was a rich man. He had sold a lot of cotton during the First World War for $1 a pound. He had some world-renowned dogs. And we hollered 3 or 4 times and they started hunting. And we listened and directly. Old Brummy didn't bark at nothing but a coon. He had a deep voice. And when he cut down on him, it was a coon. Don't worry about no possum or no bobcat. Brummy was running a coon. And then old Trailer and old Highball and them famous dogs and Mr. Barron's got in there with them, and old John Eubanks would holler, "Hey, speak to him." And my brother Sonny would holler, "Hey, look for him." And oh, it was beautiful. Now y'all get this picture. About that time they treed. we rushed down into the swamps. And there the dogs were, treed up the biggest sweet gum tree in all of Amit River swamps. It was huge. You couldn't reach around this tree. There wasn't a limb on it for a while. Way up there, huge tree. And I looked around at John and I said, John, I don't believe you can climb that tree. And it hurt John's feelings. He pooched his lips out, got fighting mad. He said, there ain't a tree in all these swamps that I can't climb. And he got his Brogan shoes off and he eased up to that sweet gum tree and he hung his toenails in that bark and he got his fingernails in there and he kept easing up the tree, working his way toward that bottom limb, and he finally got to it and he started on up into this big tree. Knock him out, John. It won't be long. And John worked his way on up to the top of the tree and whoo, what a big one. And he reached around in his overalls and got that sharp stick and he drawed back and he punched the coon. But it wasn't a coon. It was a lynx. We call them souped-up wildcats in Amit County. And that thing had great big tushies coming out of its mouth and red big claws on the end of its feet. And people, that thing attacked it, John, up in the top of that tree. Whoa! You could hear John squall. What's the matter with John? I don't have no idea. What in the world's happening to John? Knock him out, John. Whoa! This thing's killing me. The whole top of the tree was shaking. The dogs got to biting the bark of the tree and fighting one another underneath the tree. And I was kicking them back. You dogs, get away. What's the matter with John? Knock him out, John. Whoa! This thing's killing me. And John knew that Mr. Barron told him a pistol in his belt to shoot snakes with. And he kept hollering, whoa, shoot this thing. Have mercy, this thing killing me. Shoot this thing. And Mr. Barron said, John, I can't shoot up in there. I might hit you. John said, well, just shoot up in here amongst us. One of us got to have some relief. The next morning, I made my way to the country store and visited over there a little bit. This was a place that I had gone quite often. And while back over there late that evening, it was a hot afternoon. I'm standing in front of this country store at Route 4, Liberty, Mississippi. And up walks two fellas. And I look and see that they have been drinking that old Popsicle whiskey, what they make themselves. Hot, scalding July day. Fella named Bully and a fella named Simmy. And they come walking up hand in hand and said they was hungry, wanted to go in the store and get them something to eat. Now, they went in the store and bought them a can of these old mustard sardines. They come in an oblong can and they packed in a mustard sauce. And they come back out at the, in front of the store where I was and sat down on two RC Cola cases and took their knife and opened up that can of mustard sardines and bent the lid back and got over in there with their fingers eating them. And that juice dripping off of their fingers and they're putting it all up in the eyebrows and trying to eat them mustard sardines, and Bully's talking about how good they was. And up walked the third fella by the name of Lewis. Lewis was cross-eyed. He was standing looking right at him, but his head was turned looking across the road. And he was a-staring right at him. Now, friends, had you seen this sight, you wouldn't have wanted nothing to eat for at least a month. This was a bad-looking sight. But Lewis just stood there and stared at him. He just kept staring at him. And a little bit he turned and went into the store and he asked the storekeeper. He said, sir, where's them sardines? He said, they're up there on the shelf. He said, get me a can of them, cause Bully has done flung a craving on me. Right Right after that, I went into the United States Navy. I don't have too much sympathy with anybody what wants to burn the draft card or what don't want to keep this country free. I went overseas at age 17 and... On my 19th birthday, I had already received 3 battle stars and the Presidential Unit Citation. But I served my time in the Navy. I was mustered out of the service at New Orleans, Louisiana. And I got off of that fast train at Macomb, Mississippi, with a Jap rifle on one shoulder and a sea bag on another, and I was looking for a ride to East Fork Community at Route 4, Liberty, Mississippi. I went out to the sale barn and got me a ride in a pickup truck out to the house. Walked up on the front porch, and my mama said, "Baby," she still calls me baby, said, "Baby, it's good to see you. I'm glad you're home. Thankful that you're here. Now, what is it you intend to do?" I said, "Mama, do you remember how me and my brother Sonny used to sit out on the front porch and listen to that battery radio, and at Macomb, Mississippi, would be playing that football, and me and my brother would just actually cry because we lived out in the country and didn't have an opportunity to go to a high school where they played high school football. It'd be playing Laurel and Catholic High, Memphis, Tennessee, Meridian and Biloxi, and we'd listen to it on the radio, and me and my brother both thought we'd have been good at it had we'd had opportunity to have tried it." She said, "Yeah, I remember that." I said, "Well, I'm going off somewhere, and I'm going to play football. I'm going to fulfill my life's ambition." She said, "Baby, the closest thing you ever come to playing football in your lifetime was kicking a pet milk can during recess over at East Fork School in the middle of the gravel road." Said, "How in the world do you intend to go off and play?" I said, "I'm going to play. I intend to do it." Now, I wasn't fat in those days. I was 6 feet tall, weighed 214 pounds, just turned 20 years old. And I put me on one of them tight-fitting Navy t-shirts, and I sucked myself up where my physique could show real good. And I went out to Southwest Mississippi Junior College at Summit, Mississippi. Now, friends, when I walked up on that campus, them folks got to looking at me. And directly one of them walked up to me and said, "May I help you?" I said, "I'm looking for the football coach." "Come with us. We'll be glad to show you the football coach." So I went with them, and we walked into the office, and this coach jumped up and said, "Son, who are you?" I said, "I'm Jerry Clower from Route 4, Liberty, Mississippi, a graduate of East Fork Consolidated High School. I'm a football player, and I intend to enroll here this coming fall." He said, "Son, I'll give you a half scholarship just looking at you. But tell me quick, what position is it that you play?" I said, "Sir, I am the man what runs with the football. That's the position that I play." Now, friends, I went out for football 16 days. And the first college football game I ever saw, I played in it. And I started the first game at left tackle. Once a tackle, always a tackle. And I want to tell y'all something. It didn't shame me at all for them to find out I wasn't the man what run with the football. Because you asked any football coach in the world if he's ever heard of a good football team that didn't have 2 good tackles. There ain't no such a thing. But I went on and played at Southwest Mississippi Junior College, and a friend at Macomb wrote to Mississippi State and said, "I believe old Jerry Clower was worthy of a look-see." And I went on to Mississippi State, and they were good to me and patient with me, and they let me play in the Southeastern Conference. And one of my life's ambitions was to letter in college. And there I was playing in the Southeastern Conference, what played against big teams and fly around over the country. And that just thrilled my heart that I had arrived. I'm a little bit surprised that some of y'all hadn't rushed up to me tonight and said, "Jerry, I remember when you played football at Mississippi State." But ain't none of y'all done that, and it has disturbed me a little bit. I believe I can refresh your memory to where you can remember when I did play. I am the man in 1949 at the Auburn Stadium. They had an All-American by the name of Travis Tidwell. He was a fine running back. I am the man, the defensive tackle, in 1949, before standing room only, that Travis Tidwell picked up 27 yards running backwards over. Our linebacker broke through and got a hold of him and spun him around, and he had lost his balance. But them good running backs, it don't make no difference whether they're running backwards or frontwards. They still go toward their goal line unless you get them down. You watch it. This is a pretty good lesson in life. I never saw a great running back. It may take six or seven folks to get him down. But when you get him down, he's always pointing towards his own goal line. He don't point toward the other fella's goal. He points toward his. Well, our linebacker got old Travis Tidwell and spun him around, and he come running backwards at me, and I got down. I said, I'll just break your back. You all they got anyhow. And I got down and I stuck him just like I was coached to do, and I throwed my arms around him, and 27 yards later got him down the field. Those people were ugly to me that evening, I'll tell you that. As they say over there, they rung my bell. But down in South Mississippi, we refer to it as they white-eyed me. I woke up at the halftime, and I was laying on the sidelines, and I wasn't even with the team. They was in the dressing room. And when I woke up and looked around to see what was going on, one of the Auburn cheerleaders, bless her heart, had eased down there and put my head in her lap. And when I woke up and saw what was going on, I just dozed back off. I went back to Mississippi State's homecoming last year, and it sure was a joy to me to meet some of my old friends. And up drove an old boy in a long car, what had leopard skin seat covers on his big car. The car was so long you had to go to the airport nearby it to turn it around. Big diamond ring on, and it was obvious that he had done hit it rich. He was wealthy. And one of my county agent buddies was there, and I said, "Looky young. Now, if we hadn't kind of helped him through school, he'd have flunked out. He ain't got good sense." And we got to checking with him, and I said, "Man, how have you done?" He said, "Man, I'm a millionaire." Millionaire. I said, "Me and George hadn't helped you through school, you never would have got through. And here, we missed one payday, we'd have to go to penitentiary. And here you are just filthy rich. How in the world did you do that?" He said, "I'm not a greedy individual. That's why I've done it." He said, "A lot of folks are greedy." I said, "Well, just how did you earn your money?" He said, "Well, I married a very lovely girl, and her daddy was a big cattleman. And we found out that if I built me a steakhouse beside the four-lane highway, that my daddy-in-law could produce these beautiful, fine ribeye steaks for $1 a piece. And me and my wife could sell them in our steakhouse for $4. And we have done this for the last 20 years, and we have been satisfied with that 3%. We ended that football season, and I was just about to graduate from Mississippi State, and here come a letter. And this letter really put a big lump in my throat. I tore it open, and there it was. Uncle Versy Ledbetter, a man that I had known all my life, had went over to East Fork School and had got the school board to vote unanimous to write to me and get me to come back to make the graduating address at the high school graduating at East Fork Consolidated High School. Well, I hitchhiked home just as fast as I could and got down to East Fork and sat down on the wood box. And my mama was in the kitchen, and she said, "Baby, Uncle Versy's bad sick." I said, "My goodness, I hate to hear that." I said, "He's bad sick, but he claims he's going to get up out of the sick bed and come over there to East Fork tonight to hear you speak if it kills him. He's coming." I said, "Well, mama, he can't do that. I don't aim to let him do that, none." She said, "Well, you get the old truck cranked if you can and run on over there and see him and see if you can talk him out of coming. And the biscuits will be done when you get back. Now, you ladies, bless your heart, can I talk to you just for a minute? All of y'all within the sound of my voice, my mama was making them biscuits and whooping them up in a big wooden bowl. She sifted that white blossom flower through a sifter and took her hand and parted that flower in the bottom of that wooden bowl and took a gob of hog lard and put over in that and squashed it up with her hand. She didn't stir it with no spoon. Squashed it up with her hand and then poured that good clabber of buttermilk over in there and kept stirring it and working it up till she whooped up that pile of dough. Now, some folks would take a Clabber Girl baking powder can and cut them biscuit, but my mama was choking them off the end of, end of that dough there and rolling them out and take them big, pretty cat head biscuit and lay them gently in a baking pan and then take them three fingers right there and take a little all sausage grease and daub the top of them biscuit. Now, ladies, them biscuit was fit to eat. I live on Swayze Street in Yazoo City, Mississippi. Now, this is a fine street, and there are some folks on that street, some lady folks, what try to impress their husbands and cook them biscuit before they go off to work in the morning. Now, these ladies go to the dairy case at the supermarket, and they buy these cardboard sleeves or tubes full of biscuits. And the instructions say you are to whop them on the counter and open up the little biscuits and cook them for breakfast. Every morning about 7:15, it sounded like a young war on my street. They whop, 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 whop. They opening up them biscuits. And I got news for y'all. Them biscuit ain't fit to eat. But I said, Mama, I'll be back as quick as I can. I'm going to go over and tell Uncle Percy he can't come to hear me speak if he's sick. I walked in, and sure enough, he was sick, back in the bedroom. And I went back there and sat down with him. And man, it's just like talking to a post. He said, Jerry, I'm coming over there to hear you speak. I remember how you growed up here in this community, how you dropped velvet beans in the new ground for me after school, how we used to swap work, and now you done went up out of Mississippi State University and got that degree in agriculture. You done showed me how to vaccinate them cows for the black leg. And I remember when you was a little bitty boy, you used to help me drive them old poor cows up and help me treat them for the holler horn and the holler tail. Well, I've helped a many a old cow while you cut the horns off. And we slipped the tail and put that salt in there and wrapped that string around it. And now you done got this degree in agriculture and you have done found out up at Mississippi State that the only reason them cows got better when we doctored them for the holler horn or the holler tail is we always kept them up and fed them. And they didn't have holler horn or holler tail, they had holler belly. And you done found that out for me. And not only that, but you are the first young'un ever to get out of East Fork School and go off and play football at one of them big schools. And that's a record I hold up until tonight. A record I still hold. Schoolhouse burned down not long after I got out. While I was in there talking to Uncle Percy, I heard a whop and something hit the floor. Just like somebody had dropped a big stick of firewood. And I rushed out, it jarred the whole house. And that was Marcel, Uncle Percy's oldest boy. Mrs. Ledbetter had done knocked him away from the table. And he is laying on the floor looking up and said, "Oh, Mama." Now, he had done a bad thing. I got to inquiring. Now, I don't know whether y'all cultured enough to know how to eat molasses and biscuit or not, but what you do is take the plate and pour the bottom of the plate full of molasses. Now, don't get none up on the flange, just the bottom of the plate. Then take a gob of cow salve butter and put over in them molasses and take a fork and work it in good, stir it in that good. Now, it's an art to know the right amount of cow salve butter to the right amount of molasses. You got to work it in that right. Now, the way you test this, if it's mixed properly, If you drag half of a buttermilk biscuit through it, it'll tear it half in two. And Marcel was mixing up his portion. And his mama, whop, slapped him away from the table and said, "Boy, how many times have I told you to lick that knife off before you stick it back in that butter?" So I got up and went on back to the house and eat supper. Got up on the stage and there was a graduating senior sitting behind me. I was introduced as Jerry Clower, the first graduate that ever played football at Mississippi State. And I felt so good. I scared near about to death. That was the first public speech I ever made in my life. And I sincerely hope that I have improved. I've been trying to. And I got up and there was Uncle Versi and his boy Marcel sitting right on the front row. And as soon as I got on speaking, I jumped off the stage and grabbed Uncle Versi by the hand. I said, "Uncle Versi, I sure hope you get better." He said, "My goodness, son, I hope you do too." I remembered to ask Marcel, Uncle Versi's oldest boy, did he have any repercussions from the problem he had had on a beer joint what was located on the county line just about a week before that. What Marcel had done, Marcel didn't like his school, none. He didn't like them teachers, he didn't like them books. But Uncle Versi made him stay in school till he was old enough to get his driver's license and bought him a second-hand pulpwood truck. And he quit school and went to hauling pulpwood. Now, Marcel had loaded up his pulpwood truck and had took a load out to Macomb and unloaded it out there on the big boxcar what was going to the paper company. And he is driving back in the hot of the evening. It's just before sundown. That sun is staring him right in the face back out to East Fork Community where he lived. Well, now, Amite County is dry. The people are dry. And they had never voted in no kind of alcoholic beverage. But if you want to get a cool one, you have to ride over on the county line where they got a joint. Marcel was coming along there, and he'd had fine Christian teachings. He knowed better than to buy any of them cool beers. But he knew also that they had them big knee-high belly washers, and they was cold. And he wanted one of them so bad. He eased his old pulpwood truck over off the paved highway. Now, all he had on between him and the Lord was just a pair of overhauls, that's all. He was barefooted and just his overhauls on, that's all. He did have the bottom button on the sides button. The top buttons were. The top buttons was flopping. And he got eased off it, and he put it down in neutral, and he pulled an emergency brake up on his truck, and he eased up to this tavern, and he looked through the screen door and said, "Hey!" Man behind the counter and asked, "What you want?" Said, "Would you hand me a cold soda water? You better get away from that door. Go get you a shirt on, get you on some clothes. We don't want the likes of you in here. I ain't coming in. All I want you to do is hand me a cold soda water through the door, and I'll pay you for it, and pay you for the old bottle, and I'll drink it while I'm driving home." There's four fellas sitting around a table there playing this here Blu-ray card game. And one of them said, "Didn't you hear him tell you to get away from that door, you redneck?" Poor Marcel, walking on them gravels out there, went back to his truck and reached over in the tube box and brought out one of them lightweight McCullough chainsaws. And he reached down and he took a hold to that starting rope. And he walked up to the door of that beer joint and he just stuck the snout of that thing through the screen door. Whom! And he reamed him out a hole in that screen door and he eased it over to the side and it hung in that screen door. That's whop. And he held it out up over his head and ribbed it up where all them screen wires and hinges and thing had come loose from it. Whop! And then he stepped inside. Raced the motor three or four times and slung that thing at a table and just took off two legs in a table and said, "Whop!" They gave Marcel the beer joint. The Independent Oil Association of America had their meeting at a big hotel down in Houston, Texas. And they got this PhD fella from way up in the Midwest to come and make a speech. Now, folks, he forevermore made a speech. It so inflamed and enthused all of those oil folks that they called their executive committee together and they said, listen, let's hire that fella. And let's put him out on the road making this same speech just to wherever he can gather up a crowd, let him talk to them. And he did. Bought him a big car and got him a chauffeur with a blue serge suit. And this man just started traveling all over the country making this speech. Well, after they had been doing this for about 8 months, going down the four-lane highway, that chauffeur looked in the rearview mirror and he said, Professor, what? Said, there ain't no fairness in this country. My good man, why would you make a statement like that? He said, I can make that cotton-picking speech as good as you can. And I'm barely making a living on what y'all paying me, and you getting rich. He said, sir, I want you to know that I got my B.S. degree. He said, don't start all whore over you got all them things. I ain't interested in them. I done heard you make that speech once a day for 8 months. I done memorized it. I'm a better speech maker than you are, and I can make the cotton-picking speech better than you can. It's just that simple. He said, I'm fixing to go to a major university, and they ain't never seen me. They don't need to know what I look like. You pull over to the roadside park up here, we are about the same size. And we'll trade clothes, and I'll break you from sucking eggs. We'll put you up there on the stage and let you make the speech, and I'll be the chauffeur and sit out in the congregation, and I'll watch you make a fool out of yourself. That suits me fine. Let's change clothes. Now, y'all get this picture. They drive up to the big major university. The real professor with the blue serge suit on driving the big car. The chauffeur sitting on the back seat with a little briefcase in his lap. 22,000 people in the field house. Standing room only. The great PhD, what graduated from the great school of mines, was coming to speak. And they introduced him. And just as he got up to speak, there was the real professor sitting on the back row with the hardbill chauffeur's cap in his lap, peeping at him. Now, y'all talking about making a speech. Whoo, he forevermore shelled down the corn. He shucked it right on down to the cob. They throwed their books in the air, wallered on the floor, hollered, give him a standing ovation, screamed, and they finally got order restored. And the president of the school got up and said, well, we have about 10 minutes before the bell rings. I wonder if y'all would like to ask this gentleman any questions. Yes, would you like to ask him any questions? Well, y'all have seen the type. A fella got up in the, about halfway back with big horn-rimmed glasses on, a real egghead, had books under each arm. He said, Professor, if one of those dinosaurs died what roamed the earth 2 billion years ago and his carcass rotted and the earth's atmosphere built up layer after layer after layer to 5,986 feet and 2 billion years later a drill bit drilling a well on a wildcat venture bores through this decayed carcass, what will the pH of the soil be that's contained in the core of the drill bit? And what will be the name of the stratosphere? This fellow just stood there and looked at him. You could have heard a pin drop. And this fellow said, Mr. Student, as long as I've been in this business, that's about the most simplest question I ever been asked since I've been speaking. I'm surprised they'd let a man that don't know no more than you know get in this university. And just to show you how simple the question is, my chauffeur's in the back of the room. I'll ask him to stand up now. Friends, everywhere I go, most folks are mad about something. And I'm serious. This bothers me to a great extent. I'm concerned about it. And I just wonder, what can we do about it? Well, everywhere I go, the folks that are mad, they're mad at the folks in the next county, or either mad at the folks in Washington. And I'll say, well, sir, what do you think can be done to straighten out our country if it is in a mess? And they'll always have some fine way to do it, but it won't never involve them doing any different than the way they're doing now. What is wrong with this country? You know, everybody gives advice. Everybody wants us to do this way or do that way. But friends, I conscientiously believe from the bottom of my heart that good citizens make up a good country. And I think good citizenship, number one, is that we live by the rule book of life, the Holy Bible. If you want to play football, you got to play by the rules or they'll throw a red rag down and step off a penalty against you. If you want to play basketball, you got to play by the rules or they'll blow a whistle and make everybody back up out of the way and let you toe a line and shoot a free pitch unmolested. You want to play ping pong, they got a ping pong rule book. Baseball the same way. If you want to live, go to the book that the Creator, the one that made you, wrote for you to go by, the rule book, the instruction book. And this is the greatest need in America today. And in order to be a good citizen, we should simply associate ourselves with Bible-believing people in a Bible-believing church. And we should put our membership in that church, and we should so strive to live by the rule book of life that would be the first thing in our citizenship. Number two, we would be qualified electors. We would register and vote. Number three, we will serve on the jury in order to be a good citizen. Number four, we'd invest some money in a local industry. Number five, we'd set the proper illustration for young people to follow. My, it's been good to talk to you here this evening. I sincerely appreciate you listening to me. And I want all you good people to know that I have four children. Ray, age 17, Amy, age 15, Sue, age 8, and little Katie, age 4 months. And we're proud of little Katie, we really are. And I want all of you good people to know, if any of you ever come to Yazoo City, Mississippi, I want you to come by and visit with my wife and me, because we got so many different ways y'all bound to like some of them. Thank you so much.